Welcome again to another session of Tiffin Talks. Today we have with us one of the most talented actors. I would not say rising because he has been around for some time. I still remember the time when I saw his cameo in Luck by Chance, fabulous movie. And of course, most recently, Made in Heaven. And we have with him, obviously, our master of ceremonies, Kaveri Bamzai, a noted author and journalist herself. Over to you, Kaveri. Take us through now with this journey with Arjun Mathur. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Hello and welcome to Tiffin Talks, Arjun. It's such a pleasure to have you with us. Congratulations on the nomination, on the International Emmy nomination. How does it feel? I know a lot of people have asked you this question, but how does it feel?
Well, it's pretty amazing. I think I have never before been in a position where I have the opportunity to make the country proud. Mm-hmm. So that's huge. It took me a while to believe that it's happened, and it sank in very slowly. I'll be honest, it's now been a month since the announcement came. It feels like about a week because it's been a bit of a frenzy, you know, of press and a lot of messages and stuff, and I haven't had too much time to stop and think and feel too much, you know.
But Arjun, it really lends credence to the idea that if you persist with your craft, if you keep your head down, keep working, just stay true to your art and your profession, things do change. So it's not always what happens in Luck by Chance.
Yeah, I do believe so. I mean, you know, over the years, that is certainly what one has had to tell oneself.
Yeah.
To just so you can stay on the path, you know, instead of kind of giving up. But I guess I am now a testament to the fact that, yeah, eventually things do work out, you know. You can go through your journey and feel like it's taking long or whatever it is. I think the key is really to stop comparing your journey to other people's. And, I believe good things happen eventually.
Absolutely. And, your journey, Arjun, has been studied with such cinematic and streaming gems, you know, whether it was Luck by Chance, which is really an extraordinary film of its time. I still remember when it came out, we'd not seen such a brutal takedown of the industry for a long, long time, you know.
Yeah.
And yet there was a certain amount of affection, but it was quite a brutal film. And your role in it was really quite, it took a lot of turns. And then, of course, Made in Heaven again, on the surface, seemed so beautiful and so beautifully put together. And there's really such a heart of darkness to it. And that's really a comment on where we are as a nation and society. So talk a little about being part of such amazing projects, even in the two short films you did, which was so revolutionary for their time, you know. Whether it was Migration or whether it was the one that was directed by Positive, the one that was directed by Farhan.
Yes, yeah.
So it may be work that is less, but it speaks a lot, you know. So there's obviously something that you're doing right when you're choosing your scripts.
First and foremost, I want to say, because you named these two specific projects initially, and of course Farhan's short film also, I have to give credit to Zoya and Farhan, you know, as producers, as creators. For Zoya, firstly, too, because she really has that eye for casting in particular, you know, and I feel very lucky that a filmmaker like her, by far, really one of the best in our country, believes in me and has been a part of my journey for over a decade now. And so I consider myself really fortunate to be in that position. The rest, you know, honestly speaking, there's only so much of, I only pick and choose from the best of what comes to me, you know, stuff that resonates with me at the end of it. There are many, many, there are many things I want that don't work out. There are many things that don't even come to me. I will say that my choice has been affected by my initial days in the industry, I think, where, you know, because of those two short films you mentioned initially, I think I immediately gained this label of an actor who does, like, you know, issue-based films and serious stuff, you know, for that point in time. It was 2007.
Yeah.
And then came Luck by Chance, in which it was a great part, but a supporting part nonetheless. And I found myself post Luck by Chance and My Name is Khan, etc. I found myself kind of getting slotted as this embellishment in star vehicles. And, you know, it was not, I was not happy with that. And I just started instinctively focusing on smaller films that were more content heavy and gave me more to do. You know, they were small, but they were my projects. They were on my shoulders. So I feel really proud of most of those small films that I've done. So I think that's just one thing leading to another. And then as I started realizing that Bollywood works the way it works, and, you know, I thought it's best for me to kind of just find my way around that rock, you know, create a path where, okay, maybe then I can reach a much wider audience with my work. And, you know, I started trying to expand. I got an agent in London and was part of a British TV series. And
Indian Suckers was hugely popular on Channel 4, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. Yeah.
It became something of a staple. And I think it made quite a star of the other guy in it, Nikesh Patel.
Nikesh, yeah. He's doing quite well. I recently saw him in a big Disney movie.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
So, but you're doing very well as well, so it's fine. You played the revolutionary there, very angry young man.
I did. Yes. It was really one of the best. I mean, that shade of character was something I had never ever done before. So it was great. And it was my first experience with this format of, you know, 10 episodes and a 10 episode series where there are different directors who are, the directors are changing through the episodes. And it was my first experience with that. Made in Heaven being the second.
Sorry, I interrupted you. So you were saying that, did this series, Indian Summers, and then you sort of saw that your work was reaching out to a wider audience.
Yeah, I mean, that's just, that instinctively became what I wanted to do. I thought, you know, once I realized that, okay, this is it, and commercial Bollywood, so to speak, is quite a narrow audience, you know, so to speak, like our single screen audience is only so wide. And now with streaming platforms where we have the opportunity for our work to reach every corner of the world, I mean, that's certainly the direction I'm aiming for, you know?
Absolutely. And it doesn't matter anymore, Arjun, where you're based, does it?
Yeah.
You can be based in India and, you know, you can audition for anything in the world and get cast anywhere. And
absolutely.
The world is a lot more sensitive to colorblind casting now, isn't it? And you could pass off as anything.
Like today, there are actually parts being written which are not only are the writing parts for people of diversity, but they are also, when a script is written and a character that could initially be written as a white Caucasian male can now be imagined as anything. You know, the creators themselves, they look at it and they're like, okay, but this can be any ethnicity.
Exactly.
So the world is really opened up in that sense, I think. I think I'm existing right now over here at a very exciting and important time.
Right. We've seen Ali Fazal, for instance, doing so well for himself. And another actor who champions other actors as well, which is something I like a lot about your generation. You're really competitive, but you're not nasty to each other, I think.
No, you know, I think there is a breed of actor, you know, firstly, because you mentioned Ali, I'll say that he was one of the first people to reach out to me when the nomination came and sent me a lovely voice note and we were having a conversation. And this is what came up, that, you know, this nomination actually is, it feels like a win for many actors like me.
Yeah.
You know, and there are many of us who have been around for really long. We've been doing our thing, you know, side mein, chota mota. And between us, I know that we all feel the same. We all have the same struggle. So I think there's naturally a lot of empathy towards that struggle. And so I think, yes, we do all champion each other quite a bit. You know, actors like even Rasika, Shweta Tripathi, a whole bunch I can name, who happen to also be the actors now that it excites me to be working with.
Absolutely.
You know, there is a breed of actor that I will definitely say that we're all very competitive with, and we want what they have, you know. but between us, I think we only get happy. There is envy is part of the, you know, part of the journey, but we're generally very happy when something happens, something good happens for one of us, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
And I see Rasika, for instance, doing so well. I mean,
imagine
having two streaming series on two channels at the same
time. Yeah, I know.
Talk about, you know.
I actually messaged her that evening. I was like, I'm literally just binge watching you for the last like 3 days.
Yeah.
You know.
Too much of a good thing. But
yeah.
That's so wonderful, isn't it, Arjun? Even Made in Heaven, you know. It was such a, I mean, it was so dark and... there were a lot of brutal truths in it, but it was so beautifully put together and so beautifully written. And it had such wonderful cameos by a range of actors.
Really
talk a little about working with Zoya after so many years from Luck by Chance, how she has progressed and how you have progressed as well.
Oh, Zoya's always been so special. I must tell you that, you know, like in 2005, I had just finished working on my last film as an AD, Rangde Basanti. And just around then, I had met Zoya and we had connected. And she's really been involved, like since the first time that I was sending out my portfolio pictures, she helped me choose those, you know. And then, of course, there was Positive and Luck by Chance and all this. And I think somewhere Zoya wanted to do more for me, you know. But because post Luck by Chance, she would always... whenever we met, she would say to me, I owe you, I owe you. And I would just be like, you don't owe me, you know, whatever. I didn't understand quite what she meant, really. And and then, in fact, she spoke to me well before she made Zindagi Na Milegi Dobara. And she said that, you know, this film, Luck by Chance didn't make too much money. I have to make money with this film. I'm going with stars, you know. So like, yeah, of course, do what you have to. And then came Dil Dharakne Do. That also didn't work out for whatever reason. Did
you audition for anything in either of
them? I was approached. I did not end up auditioning because there was a date clash that was not working out. But yeah, and then came Made in Heaven, where suddenly she was not bound by the shackles of the box office, you know. And she had the opportunity to make braver choices, not just in the content and the storytelling, but with the cast and crew that she could work with. And I think, again, I feel so blessed that the second they had this opportunity, I'm the first person they thought of, you know, like Made in Heaven. Zoya and Nitya had me in mind before they ever actually approached me with it. So so I mean, and then when I of course went for and initially it was just an audition. It had been 10 years since I had worked with Zoya. I went for the audition. I gave an audition. They mentioned nothing to me about the part as such. And then the second time I went in is when they briefly let out to me that, you know, this part might be gay. We're just still trying to figure it out, which is, of course, hogwash because it was all written. But they were right in expecting a little resistance because I had played a homosexual twice before in my career. Exactly. And
my God, that's like,
yeah, yes, exactly. So I went in with that bit of, I went in my first meeting with them. I expressed this to Zoya that, you know, for the third time, really, this is not all I want to be known as, you know. So she heard me out and she just said, okay, just take it home and read it. And it took me one night to read those episodes. And by the time I put it down, I was blown away by the writing and just what this show was, the stand that it was taking against patriarchy and misogyny and all these archaic, traditions and laws, the strong stance that it was taking in support of the LGBTQIA+ community. And lastly, the fact that it seemed to me it was primarily told from a female perspective, which I thought, at this point in time, is an extremely important one to be putting across in the world. So yeah, it was an immediate decision. I was like, I just called her the next morning. I was like, okay, I take back everything. Thank you for this, you know? So yeah, it was beautiful. And it really did feel like a homecoming of sorts, you know, working with XL after 10 years on a project like this, which clearly has changed my life a little bit. And That's it.
And how is it working with Shobita again? A really talented woman.
Yeah, it was great. I mean, we only met, we met for the first time on our look test at the Excel office back when they were still trying to convince the Amazon team that these are our two people. Okay, so we had to do a look test and everything and do a couple of scenes to show them. And it was great. I think there was an immediate comfort and connection, you know, in our mostly, I would say, in the artistic side in both of us. You know, she's like really deep into her poetry and this, that.
Oh, my God. Yeah. She's really, she lives in a dream world. You
she
know?
Does. She does, you know. And that's it. And then, of course, once we stepped into filming, it all flowed really naturally, you know. I would not say that today we're the best of friends, but there is a comfort and an unsaid understanding between us that there is a deeper part of us that knows each other really well, you know. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, on screen and I guess off it somehow, there must be a bond, you know.
Yeah.
It comes out so beautifully on screen. But Arjun, you know, one of the things that Nawazuddin Siddiqui once told me was that, you know, this is in reference to what you said about the hero's best friend.
Yeah.
He said that he did a lot of those parts in really big, showy movies because he wanted to make sure that people would come to his smaller films. Otherwise, they would never ever come to his smaller films. And his struggle, of course, much longer than yours, you know.
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
13 years in the industry, you're a baby compared to him. You know, that's another way of looking at things.
You're absolutely right.
How do you see that?
No, you're absolutely right. You know, I have no defense against that, actually, because you're totally right. You know, there's even an actor like Rajkumar, for example.
Yeah.
I mean, like, he did everything, you know, when before he really broke out with Queen.
Yeah.
He really did anything and everything. And I really find that commendable. I think I have nothing except like to each his own, you know. And I think that's what that every person finds their path, I guess, however they have to. I think the important thing is really to be following your own instinct and staying true to yourself, you know.
Right.
And I just found that, I mean, there's a very large, big part of me that also doesn't want to be a part of things that don't match my own sensibility, you know.
Yeah.
So that, I think that is also paramount. Like, I'm not working to win over the single screen audience. I'm not.
Yeah.
I would rather be working to, I want to have people who are somewhere in my realm of understanding, connect with my work, you know, people like yourself, perhaps, you know, like, I want to make my friends and family proud before anything, you know, and I want to try as I can to just expand the horizon of our cinema and improve the quality of it, you know.
I don't want
to be doing okay, this is what I should do because this is what will make the money, this is what will get me this, get me that, but then I feel that I'm just falling into the same rut. And I've also seen many promising actors whom I have personally thought very highly of and greatly respected in their initial struggling / independent days, who after they get everything change completely and completely change the kind of work they do. So I don't know. I it's important for me to maintain my respect for myself first.
Of course. And everyone has their own journey. Everyone has their own idea of how they want their career to be shaped. The other thing, when we talk about diversity and we talk about playing gay characters, one of the interesting things that Oni said to me once was that when he made I Am, and of course you were in it, and Made in Heaven, they, you know, although 10 years separate those two works, there's not been that much of a progression in the way gay characters are portrayed on screen. Would you agree with that? There is a certain kernel of truth in it, but I'm not sure it's entirely true.
I would say that if we are comparing a migration to a I am to a made in heaven, then I would say that there's not any progression that's required there per se. Yeah. Not, you know, because there's these filmmakers, Ameera, Anonir, Azoya, they are of that they have that sensitivity, they yeah. have the maturity, they're not interested in misrepresenting the community.
Right.
So the growth doesn't really need to happen there. If you're referring to representation in commercial cinema, yeah, I mean, I'm afraid I'm not seeing it much anywhere. Uh-huh. You know, sure, there's this Shubh Mangal Zyada Saavdhan that came. Apparently, there's a Dostana 2 that's being made. Let's hope
I
and pray.
Yeah.
Exactly. So I'm afraid we're still not seeing it enough. We're not seeing enough. I think we have a long way to go. I mean, we have such a long way to go that I eventually, of course, want to see gay characters represent themselves and gay actors
yeah.
represent themselves instead
because
of...
Because they have to come out, Arjun.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So
that's just a big struggle. So
that's what, and I think that's what we're trying to do, you know, even with migration, even yeah. with I Am, even with Made in Heaven, all we are trying to do and what I have tried to do 3 times now is just try and normalize it a little bit so that there are more and more actors who are okay with doing this so that the gay actors are then comfortable with coming out, you know? So I guess everyone has a certain part of the chip that they can, the part of the block that they can chip away at. And
yeah.
this is mine, you know?
Yeah. So Arjun, how does a boy born in London to a hotelier father, right?
That's right.
Goes to school all over. I mean, how many schools have you been to? I was just looking at your Wikipedia.
Five if you count Riverside Nursery School in Old Delhi. but yeah, I mean, well, I was just born in London, firstly. I was not, my maternal grandfather, he was into garment import and export. He had an office and a home there. So my mother just spent part of her pregnancy and delivered there, and then we came back to India. You know, that was what happened. So,
right.
But it's all over that, huh? He's born in London. People
yeah,
think I'm...
It makes you very mysterious and enigmatic.
Wow. Wow. Okay, cool. I'll take it.
Yeah, take it. Take whatever.
But, and then my father, he was a hotelier. He used to work at the Oberoi Palace in Srinagar back in the day when,
wow.
you know, yeah, when all when, the Hindi...
And all the Yash Chopras of the world
exactly.
would go there.
Exactly.
That is where you became a Bollywood.
It's possible because when I was a baby, when I was a kid in Srinagar, apparently at the same time, like Satte Pe Satta was shooting on the Oberoi Palace grounds. You know that whole shed in the film.
Yes, yes, yes.
So all this stuff. But I maybe spent like the first 3 years of my life there. I don't remember anything.
But and, those are supposed to be the most formative. So
yeah,
that's when
yeah.
the first scene
yeah.
was shown.
Yeah, probably. But I would say that it was my growing up in Old Delhi from the time I was young till about 9-10 years old, where, you know, Delhi is a really star-struck city. You know, Bombay is a little bindas because it all happens here. But growing up in Old Delhi at the time, I was just completely floored by these... Amitabh Bachchan to begin with, Anil Kapoor after that, like, you know, and all his Tezab and Ram Lakhan Jaanbaz phase. And then when I was about 9 or 10 years old, my family moved to Bombay.
Right.
My dad worked in the Ambassador Hotel in town.
Wow.
We lived on Marine Drive. I went to St. Mary's School in Baikula. And I think those were the years where it really, you know, once we were in Bombay and so surrounded by film glam, and you know, the first time I went on a film set, I remember it was Subhash Ghai Saudagar. And
Subhash Ghai.
Yeah, and I was just like, okay, wow, I think this is what I want to do, you know. So I was really young when the germ had kind of been set, and I didn't tell my father until then I went through a bit of a family tragedy. My mom passed away.
That was very, really sad. I'm so sorry for your loss.
Yeah, no, it was pretty tragic. We were all young. And so we moved back to Delhi to be closer to extended family and stuff. And then I finally finished my school from the British school in Delhi. And that's when I told my dad that, okay, you know what? I don't want to waste my time getting a degree because this is what I want to do with my life.
Right.
So he thought I was crazy to start with. I mean, and he believed for a few years after that, that I was getting a degree by correspondence, complete lie. But yeah, and that's it. I just started trying to, I'm like, okay, I'm not going to college. Let me find whatever courses I can. So I came to Bombay, did Kishore Namit Kapoor, went to Delhi, did Barry John.
Right.
And then I moved here and started working as an assistant director because I was like, this is what's going to be my actual training, you know. And that's it. That was the beginning of it.
How was it as an assistant? No, but you also went to the Lee Strasberg. Okay.
Yes, that was after my 4 years as an assistant, 4 or 5 years as an assistant director.
Okay. How are you as an assistant director? Say, Rangdi Basanti.
Yeah.
Interesting film to be part of.
Yeah, they were all pretty amazing.
Again, being from Old Delhi, you must have bonded like mad.
Yeah. They were all interesting. Like, I mean, my first film as an AD was a film called Kyun Ho Gaya Na. And it had, it had Amitabh Bachchan and Aishwarya Rai. And it was a really exciting project for me to be a part of as my first film. And I was handed over to the costume department as their runner, basically. And horrible, but good, great experience.
What did you have to do as the runner?
Oh my God, everything. I used to go for actors' measurements, trials. I used to go fabric shopping, buying, collecting swatches for fabrics, getting clothes made. I mean, and then like labeling, sorting scene by scene. It was horrible. It was horrible work.
Obviously don't enjoy fashion at all.
No, I don't. I don't. I'm sure you can tell by my public appearances. But anyway. But it was fun. It was fun. Then came The Rising, Mangal Pandey, which was a big film with Aamir Khan. And I was really excited to be on that. Then I was called on Bunty or Bubbly as continuity supervisor, which is something and it was crazy. And I met some great people and made some lovely friends on that film. And I wanted to stop, but the projects just kept getting so exciting that I was like, okay, after this one, I'll stop. After this one, I'll stop, And finally, it was Rangde Basanti, I think, which was the cherry on the cake. And finally, after that film, I was like, okay, I'm getting old. So I need to start doing what I came here to do. And but those years, I will say, they were like my college years, they were absolutely carefree and amazing and having fun, living unhealthy, zero discipline. And it was just fun,
And there was a whole lot of you, I guess, people like Kiran and
Absolutely. Like Kiran was, I remember so clearly, Kiran was working on Swadesh when we were shooting Rising in Panchgani, and Swadesh was shooting in Y. And I remember the first time Kiran came to visit Aamir sir on our sets, so
very exciting for you.
Yeah, it was. And
one
then
of
I was
your at, 80s is becoming
and then I was at their wedding and beautiful. Yeah, those days were really golden, I would think. A lot of us, like so many people, Advait, Shakun, I mean, so many of us who started as ADs are today like all doing such amazing things. It's really awesome to see.
That's what I wanted to discuss with you. Another thing, Arjun, that actors like you have created an ecosystem around yourselves as well. All of you have, in a way, someone who looks out for you, And I think that's very important. Say Rajkumar has Hansal Mehta. How important is that for your sanity, not just for your work but also for your sanity, that at least there's someone who looks out for you? Because otherwise you're all from nowhere,
All right, okay, let me be completely honest.
First
and foremost, everybody here is looking out for themselves.
Okay.
So it's so, while looking out for themselves, while looking out for ourselves, if we have the opportunity to help people and, move and find a band of people with whom we can move forward together, that's ideal. But yeah, but I will say it's not essential, you
and
know.
It doesn't always happen.
Yeah, it doesn't always happen at all. I mean, I sure, I did a luck by chance, but then I also had 10 years after that where I did nothing with XL Productions.
Right.
And sure, now I have again, but now for the next 10, 15 years, maybe I won't again. Who knows? Right. So the most important thing is really to first and foremost, just believe in yourself. And, you know, friendships are like real friendships are rare in this industry.
Right. Everything you know? Is transactional.
Things are transactional. Even our friendships, let me put it this way, like even the friends we've made through work. Hmm. You know, the friends we've made in Bombay, we have made through work. So work is what we talk about. Work is what we discuss with each other. And so, no, I'm not saying it's this cutthroat and nobody is looking out for each other. But I'm just saying that first and foremost, like everything and every most of the times when people are helping each other, it's a mutually beneficial
thing,
you know. And yeah, I think
that's... From the outside, it looks a little romantic, but it may not always be so.
Yeah, it's not. It's not really because at the end of it, honestly, it is a business, as I've learned the hard way, you know. So that's because otherwise, though, sure, there are so many people whom you know, even from like your earlier days, you know, from your... There are people working in the industry whom I have known since before any of us were in the industry, you know. And but no, we're not necessarily here to look out for each other, you know. I'm just being completely brutally honest.
Yeah, but I mean, as you always are.
Yeah, I guess.
Is there still a class system? I mean, there's the YRF crowd and the Dharma crowd, and then there's the rest and the Anurag Kashyap crowd, which is sort of a floating group, and then there's the rest of you.
I think that's just it, you know. Like as you said, like I wouldn't call it a clique or anything like that. I would just call it a bunch of people whose frequency kind of matches with each other, and they tend to stick together and tend to work together. And these are also intermingling, you know, and actors can be part of more than one or two, or you know what I mean? And in fact, should be. But I will say, yeah, sure, there are, you know, like in anything, there is a certain level of hierarchy and elitism in any field and every field. And yeah, so it is in Bollywood as well, you know.
How easy is it to let it get to you? Because we've seen that during this COVID. I think, you know, say someone like Sushant Singh Rajput was so successful from the outside, but who knows what he was comparing himself with?
Yeah, absolutely. It's very easy. It's really easy to fall into that trap of
rabbit hole. And once you're down that rabbit hole, there's no coming out.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, like, I have been in a position at the lowest point in my career. I have felt that I want to get out of here, that, you know, nothing. I've spent a few years being extremely bitter and angry at the industry and all of that. I've been through this spectrum of emotion. Yeah. And that's what, and at the end of it today, I realized that first and foremost, the industry belongs to nobody.
Yeah.
You know, and we're all and there is space for everybody. You just have to find your people here, honestly speaking. That's it, you know. And even that doesn't mean like go out and find people who can benefit you.
Right.
I just mean like form your own genuine connections with creative people who are also struggling here with you.
Yeah.
And that's it. And things will just kind of grow out of that, you know. But it is really easy for it all to get to you, and it takes a lot for one to be like, okay, forget it, I'm gonna keep walking, I'm just gonna and that's what I did, you know. I mean, like every time I faced a rejection or a roadblock or every time I was down in the dumps like this, I tried to turn all those experiences into my fuel, honestly. You know, I just was very, very certain that, okay, I understand what's happening. I am bitter about these things. This is wrong. That is wrong. But it doesn't mean that I have to succumb to any of this. I will find my own way through this, you know.
Right.
And yeah, and today I have an Emmy nomination. So,
yes. So things always work out. But do you have a spiritual practice, or do you sort of do anything to work on becoming mentally tougher?
I think I don't have an active spiritual practice. I think
But you have love.
I do have love.
Yes.
I do have love, which is a spiritual practice. And I would say that now I try to have become deeply philosophical in life, and I look at life as a spiritual practice. So
that's a nice one, huh?
Yeah. And otherwise, I try to travel as much as I can, because I think like just spending time away in nature is the greatest time to reflect and, you know, just keep yourself together. I don't, strangely. I think life has taught me enough spiritual lessons. And I think now I just like reached a Zen space, you know.
I wonder, what does your dad think about your choice now? What does your family think?
It's varying. Yeah, sure. Did you say, should we talk about it, or does my dad talk?
Do you talk about it with your family?
Well, my brother is someone I'm extremely close to. With my brother, I share every script of mine before I read it.
Oh, really?
Only if he tells me, yes, read it, then I read it.
does he do?
He lives in the UK. He actually is a stay-at-home husband. He's not too well. His health is not the best. So his wife works, and he takes care of the home and his 16-year-old daughter.
Oh, that's
cool. Yeah, but we are extremely close, and he's always been my, rock for many things. And and my sister too. I speak to her about it all as well, but she does not have the capacity to read the way my brother does. So my father is a tricky one, because he... for many years, of course, as father sons are, you know, but for many years, I faced this kind of thing from him, you know, where I would share some news about some project I'm doing with him. And his first question to me would always be, commercial hai ya nahi hai, you know? And so, of course, as a dad, like, he wants to see me be a part of big films and, you know, make a big name. And that was not quite happening where he was concerned. So, which of course was bothering me, you know, each time it bothered me each time it happened. But I think today things have changed. Yeah. And I'll share that, you know, the other day, about 2-3 days after this nomination came, and I was on FaceTime with my family, and my father says to me that, Arjun, beta, I love you so much and I'm so proud of you. And I'm like, wow, Dad, I don't think you ever said that to my face before. And he said, yeah, I haven't. And so I was like, okay, cool. If it takes an Emmy nomination, hua to sahi.
Absolutely. I think we should take whatever love and affection comes our way.
Yeah.
No matter, you know, how it happens, I think.
Correct.
So what is the way forward for you, Arjun? Because, you know, there's a world of opportunity now, especially the Emmy also will give you a bigger global profile. Do you have agents in the UK, in the US? Are you seriously considering working across the globe, which you could very well do more of?
Yeah, very much so. I am indeed. I, in fact, last year was getting an award at the Chicago South Asian Film Festival. I took the opportunity, made a trip to LA. I have a manager in LA. I have PR in LA. And we're on the lookout. Absolutely. I want to work all over the world.
Absolutely.
And over here as well. I mean, like, here I want bigger, better opportunities. So there's really no limits, you know, to where I want to go.
Yeah. What is the kind of work that's coming to you now, Arjun? There must have been a distinct shift from what was earlier, after Made in Heaven, I think.
Yeah. There's been a lot. There has been a lot of work that has been coming post Made in Heaven, but I'll be honest, not too much that has excited me. The first thing to come post Made in Heaven 1 week later was a protagonist, like a very important part in a as a gay character in a commercial Bollywood film.
Oh.
And which I
that's
yeah
not something you
yeah you know
want to do. I can and, already picture what it's going to be like.
Yeah, exactly. And there's a lot. There's so much content, you know, being created for the streaming world. But I'm sorry, but not all of it is up to the mark at all, where mm-hmm. I'm concerned, you know. Yeah. So I'm being very, very picky and choosy. I always was. And now all the more, I feel like post Made in Heaven, unfortunately, really have upped my standards. I'm really holding out for something that really grabs me, you know. One or two things have. Let's see. I mean,
there was a movie that you were supposed to shoot in London, right? I think it got postponed because of COVID.
That's right. It was called Lord Curzon Ki Haveli, being made being made by Anshuman Jha, and a very interesting cast of Rasika Duggal, myself, Paramrata, and good actors. Let's see. Now we're trying to figure. UK has just gone on another 1 month
lockdown. Yeah.
So things are just so iffy. It's really sad. I mean, even Made in Heaven, we were shooting in May. We would have finished shooting the season by now. But here we are.
So how does an actor like you keep it together during this time?
I think
for everyone.
Yeah.
But, you know, actors especially.
I think I was personally very fortunate. I don't think there were many actors who had the opportunity to create two projects from the confines of their home and release them, which I managed to do. One was a short film for Netflix called Home Stories.
Home Stories, yeah.
And then there was The Gone Game on Hoot.
Right.
And so these two things were pretty amazing. And I'm very, like, so grateful that I had the opportunity to channelize all those feelings into this work, you know.
Right.
But
and they were appreciated,
both of them, yeah.
Yeah.
But let's not fool ourselves together. Those two were just 1 week of shoot and we were in lockdown for a much longer time.
Yeah.
So it wasn't easy, you know. I realized very soon though that this period can get, I mean, it's so easy for anyone to like just spiral downward. The kind of uncertainty and paranoia and everything that we were facing.
Yeah.
It just immediately became really apparent to me that it's most important to just maintain your mental equilibrium first. So I threw all other thoughts out of my head and I just focused on a day-to-day living of and doing whatever it took to feel good on a day-to-day basis, whether it meant eating whatever the hell I wanted or drinking more alcohol than I otherwise do or watching TV for 48 hours straight. I think it was really important for everybody to not not compare our productivity with someone else's.
Yeah.
And just be, you know.
Because we live in such a hyper-competitive world, even for our leisure.
Yeah.
Competing with each other, you know.
Yeah.
Who gets to do leisure better.
Yeah, like look at my cleaning, look at my cooking. It's just like...
look at the way I'm doing jharu pocha.
yeah. And like even, sorry, I'll say this now, you know, because at the time I was even, it was really irking me. Like I was just seeing like some Insta live after Insta live about absolutely nothing, you know. And I mean, I'm doing this now because, okay, there's something for me to actually speak about, you know, this really wonderful thing has happened. But I was seeing so many people were just reaching out to me also to do an Insta live. And I was like, I have nothing to positive to say right now. I really don't want to even make a public appearance, you know. Please, just, yeah.
Talking about public appearances, Arjun, how important is it for a star, for an actor, for a star to get out there, wear the clothes that they tell you to wear, do the things that they tell you to do, get the sort of haircut that you're told to do? I mean, there's no end to what you're told to do, right?
I will say that all these years, most of my years, I've really not cared too much about any of it. Unfortunately, it's part of the game. You have to. And you should also. I mean, like if someone is giving you clothes to wear, of course you should post about their clothes.
Yeah.
You know? There is a lot of stuff that should be done and has to be done as part of the territory. but it is all sometimes just so far removed from the actual act of acting, you know, which I just have some difficulty reconciling with. So yeah, I mean, I think it definitely helps, you know. I mean, in today's world, people are actually getting cast on account of their Instagram numbers. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I guess it's really important now. But at the same time, I think it's okay if there are people out there who don't want to give it too much importance, because I think those people are also important, you know, in some way.
Right.
Yeah, because there has to be some level of authenticity remaining to what we do, you know, rather than just like keep putting out photos of the clothes we wear, you know. I don't know.
No, and also, you know, not taking our craft seriously enough, you know.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
You know, you think pushing the boundaries, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, that's one thing on which I agree with Kangana Ranaut. You know, us raising mediocrity to that level, we think, oh, this is such a terrific performance, but it's actually nothing, you know.
Absolutely. No, I totally agree with you. There is so many things I hear of which are like, wow, this is amazing. And then I see it and I'm like, this is barely above average, you know. So I definitely, like I said, our standards are miserably low.
Yeah.
And I will certainly keep working, not just to keep matching mine, but to keep raising the standards of our audience and our creators, you know. Yeah.
I think the standards of our audience perhaps have been raised. I'm not sure that they're getting what you know they want.
Yeah, yeah.
But of course, you know, when they watch primetime news in the numbers that they do, it makes you wonder about their sanity as well.
Really, really does.
But you know, what really is the lesson to young people who want to enter the industry and have stars in their eyes and, you know, say, okay, you know, this is what I want to do. What do you say to them? What is the reason they should want to be in the industry?
Okay, I have a couple of things to say. And what I will not say is the advice I got when, you know, my father has this friend who was in college with him, and he's now had a long, illustrious career as a Bollywood villain and everything.
Okay.
Yeah. And I went to meet him.
Let's guess who it is.
No, I'll share. It's Mr. Gulshan Grover. Sure.
Okay. Right.
Yeah. In fact, the first time I went to a set was to meet him on the sets of Saudagar.
Okay.
And I went to meet him one day before I started acting, and you know, generally just and he was like, "Yaar, why do you want to be an actor?" You know. And I was like, "Bas yehi karna hai." He was like, and his advice to me was, "Don't. Do not do it." He said to me that you are getting into a life of misery, and why would you choose this for yourself, you know? And I was just like, okay, this is not what I came here to hear. Cool. Okay. And then that's it. And I just kind of heard it through one ear and out the other. So I won't say that. But firstly, I will say to young people who want to or are thinking about this, I would say, firstly, do not take a good look at yourself in the mirror, please, and just discern, you know. Now you're going to spend a lot of time, a lot of resources on this. So it's really important for you or maybe your family to discern whether you have what it might take and whether you're really going to put in the work, because none of it is easy. Mm. It is a life of insecurity, of self-doubt, of rejection, of comparison, of you know, judgment. And so, yeah, if you're okay with all that, go right ahead. But even then, there'll be many times that you're faced with this, you know, like, what do I do? Should I now? Okay, here's the thing. There's no real strategy or roadmap to any of this.
Right.
I think everyone has their own path. What works for one person will not work for the other person.
Right.
Everyone's unique. Everyone's journey is unique. And the only thing that I think one can actively do once you have stepped in here and are going through the churn is to, every time you're faced with the choice of, do I give up or do I keep going? The only thing we can do is keep going, because it may take 5 years, 7 years, 20 years, 25 years before something clicks. But, you know, honestly, it's only staying the path that makes something click.
Right.
You know, okay, I've had a I've had a Made in Heaven, but who knows? Maybe I might have had something 20 years later, which would have, you know, maybe I would only be known as a senior actor after spending my whole life of, you know, trying to do this. Who knows, you know?
But at least there are many more opportunities now. You agree.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes. In fact, here's another thing I will say, that forget about like trying to fit into the mold. Forget about trying to fit into a mold of what you have so far believed is conventional success or conventional hero, conventional actor.
The bomber jacket, the motorcycle, the slow motion turn.
Correct.
You don't have to enter the industry like that.
No, and train. And please do not underestimate training. That is the most important thing. And training is what will actually help you discern whether you have what it takes or not, you know, honestly. Yeah, I think there's too many untrained actors.
Yeah. And also, Arjun, the capacity to listen to people and the capacity to learn from people.
Yeah.
How important is that? Because we become so sort of isolated in our ivory towers.
Yeah.
And we forget to listen and we forget to observe.
Absolutely. That's the downfall of everything, I think, you know, because like you mentioned learning.
Yeah.
When I went to Lee Strasberg, I was 24 to 25 years old.
Mm.
But there were people there who were like up to 60 years old.
Right.
And I was just like, wow, these people are still just coming here to do nothing but learn.
Learn.
And I think that is something that you have to be open to like all your life, you know.
Absolutely.
About 3-4 years ago, I did another short course in London on the Meisner technique, just because I had 2 weeks to spare.
What is the Meisner technique?
It's completely different from Lee Strasberg's method. The method is much more internal and teaches you ways and gives you tools to kind of reach into your own experience and memory and kind of come from that place. And the Meisner technique is a lot more impulsive and in the moment and is based much more on only external stimuli and what is coming to you from there, you know. It's completely staying out of your own head and your own experience and that kind of. So there are two, there's different schools.
Yeah.
But as an actor, like, it's important to keep learning things because who knows, you know, you pick up something from here, something from there. At the end of it, we're just artists with tools, you know, and the more tools we have, the better art we'll be able to create.
But some of your movies have been so deeply disturbing. I mean, your characters, you know, and you've had such a traumatic journey on screen. So what are you, the Meisner or the method?
I think I'm more method. And yeah, you know,
so
you're
take
right.
Take your work home.
I mean, no, I won't say that. I think I bring myself completely to my work.
Right.
And like I'll talk about a film called Fireflies. I don't know if you might have seen
it. That's right.
And I'll just share, you know, that when Fireflies came to me, the first time that it came to me, I was going through a really bad patch of separation, divorce and all this. And the first time, Nandini, I remember telling her that, you know, I'm sorry, but I was going through this thing and I was kind of spending some time at home in Delhi and I was in no frame of mind to work. And that's what I told the director. I was like, this is what's happening with me. I don't feel like working. Please find someone else. Thank you. and whatever. And then they waited 1 or 2 months and 1 or 2 months of me moping had passed. And then they came back and they were like, okay, if you're done, can we shoot, you know? And I was like, okay, fine, come, I'll come. But that film and what it was and the people I was working with and everything, the way it just came together and the character's journey and the lessons that character had to learn about love, loss and forgiveness and whatnot. I mean, I just, and of course the film took me out of Bombay. We were shooting in Thailand and Sri Lanka for a while.
Right.
But through that film and that character, it gave me catharsis to everything that I was going through at that period in my life. You know, I used that film and juiced it completely to heal myself. So, So yeah, I don't know why we got here, but yeah, it was an important one. So similarly, from every project, I try to find something, you know, in that character, in that character's journey or conflict or growth. I think I try to take away the lesson of growth of every character with me. That's what I try to do. Because I think every character at the end of it has that one. The growth is the journey, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
It's wonderful. Arjun Mathi, thank you so much for talking to us. It's been an absolute pleasure. And I wish you all the best and Made in Heaven Season 2. We want it now.
Thank you so much. This was such a pleasure. I was so happy to speak to you. Thank you.
And all my best to Tia. Please tell her I loved her work on Raat Akeli Hai. Sets for that, I believe, I think.
No, Raat Akeli Hai was... which one? Sorry?
That's the one with Honey Tray and the one Honey Tray and directed...
No, she didn't do Raat Akeli Hai. Recently she did Dolly Kitty.
That's what I remembered. Oh, it was fabulous.
Right.
And the colors just popped in.
Yeah.
Please tell her congratulations.
I will, certainly. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much, Pawan. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Pawan.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much for such a lovely session. I hope everybody who has been watching us has really enjoyed it. Please do follow us on our Facebook and Insta handles by the name Tiffin Talks. And we'll be uploading this video on our YouTube channel tomorrow morning as well. See you, Arjun. Have a good evening.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank
God bless us all. Cheers.
Bye. Bye-bye. Thank you. Bye.